I want to thank everybody for being here. This is the Committee on Social Services, Veterans, Cultural, and Recreation. I'm City Councilor Mary Ann LaBarge, Chair, and also the Councilor from Ward 6. And to my right is Gina Louise Sierra from Ward 4. And to my left is Councilor Alyssa Klein from Ward 4. And I'm going to ask if the three of you... I mean, from Ward 7, sorry about that. Could you come up here and sit? Thank you very much for being here. And we have Joanne Campbell, who's the Executive Director of Valley Community Development Corporation. And we have Donna Cabana, and she's the Director of Valley CDC Home Ownership Program. And Valley CDC Development Specialist. And also we have Peg Keller, who's here in our audience, and she's from Housing and Community Development Planner. I just want everybody to know that this meeting also is being audioed and video recorded by Ruth McGrath for the Ward North Street Association, and also by NCTV. And so I have called this meeting to order. Approval of minutes of July 21st, 2014. Also, the approval of the public hearing on the resolution of vibrant sidewalks, which was held September 15, 2014. All in favor?
Aye. Aye. Aye.
Move to approve it.
And now we vote.
Aye.
I thought you did. I didn't move to approve the minutes from the last meeting.
It's Monday.
Yeah.
Okay, Joanne, you're going to be speaking about affordable housing. You're going to give an activity update and a new project on Pleasant Street. Could you talk about that?
So, Joanne Campbell, Executive Director of Valley CDC. We work on a number of areas, affordable housing, homeownership counseling, and small business development, and we only manage affordable housing as well. So I'm going to start with Donna Cabana, who's going to talk about our homeownership program.
Hi, nice to meet you all. Donna Cabana, homeownership coordinator at Valley CDC. We work with tenants who want to become homeowners and current homeowners. And each counseling session will be different for every participant. But ideally, either they have the goal of home ownership or they want to maintain their current home ownership. So generally, when we first meet with a client, we will review their household income and expenses. We'll try to get a handle on what is their net and gross monthly income. We look at the pay stubs. What are their deductions from those pay stubs? Every possible thing we could help the family with to increase their monthly income. If they're, you know, maybe they're not claiming their dependents and they're getting the big refund back at the end of the year. So we try to start with the pay stubs, go through a household budget with folks, see how much money they can either save for home repairs or save towards their purchase of a first home. So the session will look different for every household depending on the need. But we really start from the beginning. What is the income? What are the household expenses? How much are you able to save? Then we go into credit. What does the credit picture look like? Are you able to get an equity loan? Do you have the appropriate credit to go out and obtain a first mortgage? So then we begin reviewing credit reports and trying to help people clear up any credit issues, any old credit, things that have to be addressed on the credit report in order to obtain a mortgage. and or financing for home repairs. So I mean, it really depends on the family. Some families' credit's going to be really in order, but they're paying $1,400 a month for rent, and they can't possibly think how are they going to squeak a couple hundred dollars a month savings in order to meet their goal of home ownership in 2 years. So we try to come up with an action plan for that particular household of steps that they might take to get them there. Whether it's by increasing the income, reducing expenses, paying off debt. Everybody has different goals in this process because everybody's pretty much in different places. But it is very comprehensive counseling, and we really look at the bank statements. People will say, I don't know where my money is going. So we get out those bank statements with them and help them to realize what they're spending their money on and to make informed choices about whether it's paying off debts or reducing expenses, reducing household expenses. And again, this will be different for every household depending on their income, what their goals are. But we work with first-time home buyers primarily. I would say about 65% of our clients are first-time buyers. And then we have about another 35% that are current homeowners who are either struggling with high mortgage payments or trying to maintain their home in a climate where borrowing money is very difficult. It's not easy to borrow money these days, so managing home repairs with little equity can be extremely difficult. And we try to come up with creative ways to help people do things, you know, slowly over time without going into a lot of debt to maintain the property. And you know, this is a helpful thing to cities and towns, because you know, some people think you can just buy the house, move in, and that's it. You don't have to do anything to it. We all know those problem households that kind of stick out like a sore thumb, that really need a lot of maintenance. So even in the beginning, with the first time buyers, we talk to them about maintaining the property and how important it is. The money they're saving now to move forward as homeowners, they're going to need to continue saving that money to provide the maintenance and care the particular property they purchase is going to need. There's really so much involved. I know I'm giving you this like in a nutshell, but there really is a lot involved because we see a lot of problems that households have. It could be gambling. It could be, a variety of things. You know, we try to spend time talking with the person to ask them, so, you know, what are the barriers? What is holding you back from moving forward? And as we begin relating to people and finding out about them, sometimes they don't even know what their particular hardship or what their particular money problem is until they sit down with somebody and really analyze their bank statements and their spending. Because you ask people, hey, you take all these cash withdrawals out. Well, what are you doing? How are you managing this? And what are you spending this money on? I see a lot of new groceries. It doesn't appear to be groceries. People don't even know. So making folks more aware of their finances and more accountable to themselves and to budgeting. People come in and they really thank us. They're like, wow, we have no idea. Really looking at those bank statements, it opened our eyes to our spending habits, and we've really been able to reel those in and get to where we want to go and meet our goals, you know, for the future by really, really looking at things under a microscope, pretty much. I mean, because we really go through every item of paper that we ask folks for. So I have an outline and I left it on my desk. We do first time home buyer workshops. Those are 10 hours. We offer homeowner workshops called a post purchase workshop. And that's 6 hours, generally given on a Saturday, or we'll have it 2 weeknights during the week. And that's on financial planning, home maintenance, home insurance, fire prevention, safety in the home, and all the energy programs that might be going on through the utility companies and CET in Florence comes out and speaks about energy saving programs. So we, you know, anybody, we will work with anybody with a financial concern who owns a home or wants to buy a home. You know, as long as it's their goal, we will help them with credit repair, savings, trying to plan for savings for down payment and closing costs, and any financial problem a homeowner or a potential home buyer might have, any financial type situation, whether it's credit or saving or planning. Loan programs, we review, we go over all the state loan programs, all the first-time buyer programs with first-time buyers, try to explain their options as far as the lending process, the low down payment first-time buyer products. We want to make people aware there are subsidized programs in the state through the housing finance agencies, so we want to make sure people are aware of those opportunities that are available to them.
John, a question. You mentioned about homeowners and something to the effect that sometimes they have a gambling problem.
I've seen everything.
I'm going to ask you,
yeah,
what is the percentage of the gambling?
Oh, pretty low. But I mean, you would be surprised. People don't know what is causing their problem. And I'm like, well, how about all these cash withdrawals? Oh, that was my husband on lottery tickets.
Scratch tickets.
You know, unfortunately, it seems to hit the elderly more than other households. You know, they seem more interested in it. Idle time, I guess. But I have run across people with problems that, you know, and they're not even aware of it themselves until you say, well, he spends $50 a week on lottery tickets. I let him have that as his allowance. And I'm like, well, you can't afford that. You know, people don't know.
If you uncover a problem that maybe people didn't realize they had, or maybe some aspect of the family doesn't realize the problem is happening, what happens next? Are there resources you can direct people to help them with addictions
we offer a lot of referral services. We refer to countless community agencies, whether it's somebody who may become homeless because of a foreclosure, or you know, if there's any kind of home repair program, you know, that's something that we try to keep on top of, referral services. Generally, we have to tell people, you just have to say no, you know, like teenagers and things like that, husbands who buy scratch tickets, you just have to say no.
I imagine this would become almost like a therapy.
You would be surprised. I mean, sometimes I'm like, you both need to come because you both need to hear this, you know. And it's important. Some people don't want to come. They just, oh, you go over and take care of it. No, it's important that you're both here, sitting here, present. Some people are really out of control with spending, and they just have no idea. And until somebody brings it to their attention, they have no idea.
What do you do, Donna, for, say, a couple? He does have that problem, like you're talking about, or any kind of a problem, owning a home, and then all of a sudden, they're in the process of losing that home. But here they did so well for several years of making that monthly payment.
We have experienced a lot of job loss in the area, a lot of people underemployed, unemployed. People are not getting back up to their 2008 income. So we have helped a great number of households try to get a loan modification with their bank. Sometimes if a family's only a couple months behind, if they get into a repayment plan to try to repay the couple months that they're behind and they don't do a full modification. But typically if they're 3 or more months behind, and I mean, we've met with people who are 12, 24, even 36 months behind. The first time we're seeing them, they're that far behind. And we have been pretty successful. I would say we have a percentage, I'm going to say about 75% of our clients get a positive outcome with their lender through either a modification or what they call a forbearance plan, which is a repayment plan.
Because I know I have two people in my world who have been helping out for the past 5 months. Works very faithfully, always has, but ran into a problem, and I guided them to the best that I could, which I always send them to Peg Keller.
Send them my way. Maybe I already know them, so.
Well, whatever, I don't mention names.
Right, but maybe they've already been in and we're already working with them. Let's hope that's the case, but please refer them.
My question is, say if somebody has done very well for a period of time, and then all of a sudden, they're way over their heads, and then they file bankruptcy. Then they think they're back on their feet again, which a lot of them are not, only for like about 7 or 8 months to a year.
Right.
Then what happens?
Well, we really try to get people to get a modification prior to the bankruptcy. It's really important because once you file a bankruptcy, if you do not reaffirm that mortgage debt, and most lawyers, I don't know why because I'm not a lawyer, they tell the client, do not reaffirm the debt. You can walk away. You don't owe the money. I don't know why because I'm not an attorney, so I don't know the ins and outs of
bankruptcy. Have you ever had it with the bankruptcies in there?
Oh, yeah, but it can be really difficult to get into a modification situation after a bankruptcy because basically during your bankruptcy, you said you have not reaffirmed this debt with that particular mortgage lender. You basically said, I'm not going to pay them the money. I could walk away with the property debt-free. I don't owe any money to them because it is somehow included in the bankruptcy. Even though it's not a dischargeable debt, it is somehow included in the Chapter 7 bankruptcy. So it can be really difficult. And sometimes I have to tell people, call your lawyer, find this out, sign an authorization with the attorney so we can, get some information. So we do sometimes have to ask further questions and sometimes we do need to talk to the attorneys. If a person has an attorney of record, I always say we need an authorization from your attorney
that
we can work together because I'm not giving you legal advice. This person should know more than I do.
But that's heavy.
Yeah. Yep. It's complicated.
When I heard that your group, Valley Community, was excellent about helping people who apparently have gone through bankruptcy and also became very, very, they thought they were doing well, and all of a sudden, boom, right back up again.
It happens because there's, unfortunately, middle America, job stability, and, incomes are not what they used to be. Incomes are not what they used to be. People are getting paid less than they were pre-2008.
But I like that idea about planning and counseling and telling them how to spend their money. How to save them money.
Right.
Where are you wasting your money?
Right.
That's a biggie.
Well, we try to get them to come to the conclusions themselves just by, because people say, I can't afford to eat out. I go through the bank statements and they spent $350 to $400 dining out. And I put it on their budget because I will make a budget for you from what I see in these bank statements. Yeah.
Month?
Yeah, sure. It's easy. So I will say to people, okay, let's look at this together, and everybody has a copy and we all look at it together. I try to get people to come up with their own conclusions, by putting it out there to them from the bank statements.
Not the people that have dealt with predatory lenders, and that's more of the issue than their own spending, but this is a structure.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, maybe not so much in the last 2 years. I think unemployment has been the greater issue in the last 2 years. We've had a lot of people with prime loans that are facing foreclosure because of reduced income and underemployment. But yeah, in my career of doing this, I have seen a lot of families that have been victims of predatory lending.
From 2007 to 2012, it was almost all predatory loans, the big
right.
Banks. The past 2 years when that sort of has started to subside, and it's really prime loans, and they're more difficult because people don't have the income, so it's
they're not forced to offer these governmental programs, the home affordable modification programs. When you're working with the local banks, it's much more difficult to get into the modifications because they're not mandated by lawsuits to fix those loans. So it's difficult. It can be difficult.
Can you talk a little bit about just the numbers of how many families you're working with over a year, and are they repeat clients usually, and how many times on average do you see one set of people?
It differs. I have some clients that I see one time. They're very together. They have their finances in order. They just want to go over the loan products. They have some questions and want reassurance that buying a home is still a good value. So we have clients like that who you see one time, and I have quite a few. I would say, maybe 25% come in one time for a 1 hour counseling session. They go out and they'll contact me by email from there on out and report back their progress, ask additional questions, and then they'll inform me that they've purchased a home. Then I have clients who need a great deal of credit help, and they may come in weekly for 8 to 9 to a year to fix, to work on these. You know, we set weekly goals, we regroup the next week, where are we at? Have we done this? Have we taken care of this? And we cross off those goals. We make a new action plan for the next coming week, and we chip away at this terrible credit. And we had a gal who met with us from January through August, and she was called on the Habitat list for one of the homes in East Hampton. Mm-hmm. She was a lower income person, and she spent 8 months working on her credit, trying to get herself in a situation where she could, purchase a home. And she got called on the lottery, they accepted her, they drew her name, she was accepted, she's in the running. Well, she is one of the buyers of the East Street property, so we're thrilled.
When you're saying that for 8 months, they're working on her credit.
Every single week we met for about an hour.
Was her credit bad then?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, she had a lot of stuff she had to make repayment plans on and pay off some charge-offs and a lot of little stuff, stuff. And yeah.
They're doing it themselves.
They're doing it with direction. You know, they're doing, it's self-help. I mean, it's self-help. We're helping them set goals and meet those goals. It's like a support system. You know, we're supporting them to meet their goals, but they're actually doing it. They're doing the legwork. We're helping them with the letters. We're helping them with stuff. We're helping them with the wording. We'll get on the three-way calls with them to try to negotiate. But really, they're doing it on their own with guidance.
Alicia asked, we see about
200 families a year.
Council of 200 individuals or families a year.
And I would say about...
And that's not with the repeat clientele.
Those are not repeat, those are individual. And then about 300...
People always come back, though. We have people that come back.
Right, but those are individual because we have to count them for different... This is all not under Northampton's grant.
Right.
This is, we get different funding sources. And then we also see somewhere between 300 to 350 households come through the first time home buyer classes.
Those
350
a year.
How many times do you hold
the course? Ten times a year.
11.
Oh, we did 11 this year.
We did 12 this past year.
Did we? Wow.
We did 2 in May.
11 times a year.
We do every month except December.
Every single month.
Wow.
That's regional.
It's 4 2.5 hour sessions. It's 10 total hours of education. It's a lot of material. Things have changed dramatically in the borrowing arena.
We have our facilitator spends the first night doing credit and budgeting, the second night, so I don't know the exact night, but there's the whoever the bank sponsors or credit union, they do presentation on mortgage products,
mortgage
in general.
Yeah.
We have an attorney talks about legal
closing and settlement,
Home inspector talks about what they should be looking for. We have an insurance person come.
A real estate agent.
Real estate agent
talks
and
about
this is
shopping.
Generic information, not like, gee, I'm the best realtor. Come with me. We have a
very strict policy on non-endorsement policy. And, you know, these are educators. They're coming in to educate people, not to endorse themselves. So they can get about it.
We rotate between East Hampton, Northampton, and
And then whoever completes the course is then eligible for some kind of low interest
subsidized.
Depending on availability and income, you know, if they're at or below 80%, there's the Massachusetts Housing Partnership Fund Board, one mortgage, which is subsidized for people 80% of area median income. Or the Mass Housing Loan, which I believe they go to 125% of area median income. It's like $86,236 per household. For the Springfield metro area, which is us, we're in the Springfield metro. So I think they're using 125%. So if they can't get the MHP one, take a look at the mass housing loan. And if they can't get their credit score up to a 660, they could look at FHA. And the state has unveiled a new website called mymassmortgage.org. And that compares the two state products with the FHA product. And it really shows you that the savings you could get by taking one of the state products over the FHA. Because the upfront mortgage insurance premium that you pay, you have to pay a portion of that up front. It's more expensive. The closing costs are a little more expensive. Your monthly payment, because of the permanent mortgage insurance that you never get rid of unless you refinance. And that's another cost, refinancing it to get rid of it. So we try to point that out to households that this could be a potential savings for you right from the beginning. And we will compare those loans for households based on what they qualify for. And generally, I would say at least 85% of our households that come in to see us one-on-one are at or below 80%. In the classes, you know, that's a different number, because we have a lot of folks that are above 80 that need this class for their mortgage and come, you know.
They're ready to close and they have to have this certificate.
Yeah, because they're doing a mass housing loan and you have to have the class to close. So the classes are probably a little more 50-50. Some people above 80. I would say most of our folks are around 100% though, are, you know, at or below 100%.
And just because I know we have a couple of other projects, we also do down payment assistance through the City of Northampton. You know, on block grant, we have $2,000-$3,000 grants that we have for this fiscal year. We often also get, there's this equity builder program that the
lenders, the Federal Home Loan Bank of Boston, the lender, member lenders can apply for that grant money.
And so that money comes in the spring, and that's between $10,000 and $15,000 down payment money. So we always have clients lined up knowing that money's coming, and they're in a place where they're getting their purchase and sale agreement on homes. So.
Actually, the girl in the United Way article, she came into the office with a pre-approval of $159,000, and she lived in Northampton, and she didn't know. She's like, where am I going to buy a house for this? I'm not going to be able to afford a house. I'm going to have to move to Greenfield or Holyoke. And so we told her about the MHP one mortgage, and we told her about the Equity Builders program. So she was able to access. She was able to access that $14,500 towards her down payment and $500 towards the closing costs. And she did get the one mortgage with a small subsidy, I think of around $134 a month, to pay some of the interest on that loan. So, I mean, she was really in a good spot. I'm sorry she moved from Northampton, but she moved to Eastham. But
like
she got a lovely house in the Plains.
Like at the Northampton State Hospital, do you deal with that also, because there are affordable homes there?
There's no ownership. There's no ownership, affordable home ownership up there, not yet. Not that I'm aware of. I don't think there is. So it's rental and market rate housing.
Mm-hmm.
Affordable rental and market rate housing. Mm-hmm. So we should probably move on.
Okay.
Nia's going to talk about Northampton lumber.
So we have an option agreement to purchase the Northampton Lumberyard property on 66 Pleasant Street. That was all about our project already. So we plan to redevelop the site into approximately 16 units of affordable housing. There'll be 1, 2, and 3 bedroom apartments. They'll be affordable to a range of income levels. Ranging from at or below 30% area median income up to 60% of area median income. So what does that mean? We expect to serve incomes, households earning between $20,000 and $50,000 as their annual income. The building will be new construction, probably 4 stories. We will have commercial space in front Holyoke Street as well as Pleasant Street. We will have commercial spaces where we front those 2 streets. We, Valley CDC, plans to move our offices to Holyoke Street side, the less marketable commercial space.
The old lumber yard. No, Northampton Lumber Yard.
Okay, right off the market.
Yeah. Right next to the old Eagle building,
yep,
and
gotcha.
Across from our Handy Coffee. So we are, so Valley CDC will probably move its offices to the Holyoke Street commercial space. We don't have a commercial client yet for the public street space.
Where are you located now?
No. We're on Market Street.
We're on Market Street.
Fresh and Joe's Cafe.
So we applied for CPA funding and submitted an application in September. We have our first CPA meeting next week on the 29th. So we have our tech review tomorrow. So we're going to be getting input from the different boards and committees on our current plan. We also have a community meeting. Actually, we have flyers. We have a community meeting. We're going to be talking to our business abutters, and as well as a public forum that's open to the entire community. We are going to go for site plan review in front of the planning board in December. And hopefully that process goes smoothly. We'd like to have site plan approval this winter because we'd like to submit our pre-application to DHCD for funding in February. I think that we will submit a full application in March. Because of the project pipeline, there are a lot of projects in the pipeline for DHCD, and so typically projects don't get funded during the first round, and so we will submit a second application if we don't get funded during the first round. We will submit a second application next year. We hope to have funding by December 2015 at the latest, so that we can start closing on the rest of the financing that spring 2016. We are projecting to begin construction May 2016, estimating a 12-month completion date for construction. So it'll be completed hopefully May 2017, and full occupancy by August 2017.
How about the street? I think Clothen from the Clothen.
Oh, that's the lodging house that's
Half. Who's buying that one?
Half
is doing that one.
The last time I saw you, there was a discussion at the last meeting. There was a discussion about open space, and have you thought further about how to incorporate open space or a park or a playground or something?
We are still trying to figure out how exactly, because it is such a tight site, we are still trying to figure out how to incorporate some open space and green space. We will have tree screens along the railroad, and there will be a courtyard. We're not sure how exactly we'll be using that courtyard yet, but there will be a courtyard to provide some space in between. So the Eagles building is basically right next to our property line. So we're providing some space in between those two buildings for our residents. And we're also trying to figure out, we don't have access to Short Street, but we do have frontage on Short Street. But because we have had the lumberyard has had buildings blocking the Short Street access for so long that we do not have permission to use Short Street as an entryway, and so there is this sort of space near Short Street. We'd like to keep it open in case Short Street does become a public way. So we're still trying to figure out that piece, how we can get some open space there, but still keep it open for future options with Short Street.
And I'm going to talk briefly about our small business program and our existing housing units. So we also have a small business program that provides business counseling for specifically for Northampton under the CBG grant that we have for businesses with five or less employees who are all under 80% of median income. So that would include financial analysis, business plans, marketing help, both with existing businesses and with startups. And for ours, we have funding both from Northampton CDBG and also a state grant, which is Mass Growth Capital Corporation, which allows us to serve all income levels, as well as up to 20 employees. So that has a broader search, and we work with Franklin County CDC and Hilltown CDC in collaboration. And we help folks access funding. We don't have any direct financing ourselves for that, but we'll work with local banks or with Common Capital or with Franklin County CDC to both have their own funds. And then I wanted to just talk about our existing properties. We do make calls from constituents. So we own in Northampton 53 SRO units. Does everyone know what SROs are?
Okay.
And 23 of those units are specifically set aside for people coming from a homeless situation. These are all single housing. You don't have family housing. And it's a closed referral system. And what that means is that we work with the service providers who are working with homeless individuals, ServiceNet, Elliott Services, the Best Agents, SMOC Housing. So when a unit that is specifically set aside for an individual who is homeless, we send out an email to our contacts and say we have a unit available. And what we are doing is making sure that the folks who are coming into our housing also come with services. So that when ServiceNet refers Joe, these are his services that are coming. So that the goal of Valley and the service providers and our property management is to keep everyone housed and to be able to live as independently as possible in a safe and decent environment.
You're not the curator of a list.
Units that are specifically set aside for homeless folks. So we also meet on for Valley's 53 SRO, and actually for all the SRO units, whether they're set aside for homeless individuals or not, they're set aside for very low income people. Of those 53 units, 35 have rental subsidies attached, so we can serve very low income individuals. But Valley CDC, which is myself, our property management company, which is Home City Housing, which is another separate corporation, we hire them to do our property management. And the service providers, the ones that I met, we meet every other month. And we talk about the building, we talk about tenants, we talk about whatever it is that are issues that allow us to keep people housed. I mean, we don't want to evict people. We want people housed. But this is a way for us to stay connected. Obviously, they're connected on an individual basis in the sense that ServiceNet can call the service, the property manager, and say you're working with somebody directly. But meeting on a DMH comes to those meetings as well. It's really sort of looking at the bigger picture and knowing that if for some reason somebody was connected to services and they're having a challenge in a business that's affecting in the building, that's affecting the livability for everybody else in the building, someone in that meeting might jump in and say, oh, I remember him, I used to work with him when he lived on the street, I will contact him because I had a good relationship with him. So it's really been really helpful. We've been doing it for at least 5 years to help people.
What other agencies besides ServiceNet?
ServiceNet, Elliott Services, Steve Connor comes, DMH, SMOC. We invited the VA. They haven't, they normally don't come, but they're on the email list when there's a vacancy.
Yeah.
Quite a few people from ServiceNet because they both have their own property management. They run the Cot Shelter and Grove Street. And then we have the rest of our 100 units are family housing, and they do have lists. So we do have applications at our office. Those are open. So we just keep a list, and that's our property management company does that. And the paper I gave you, this one lists where the properties are, and just sort of gives a little blurb about whether they're an SRO, if there are subsidies attached. And that includes some of the family units as well have subsidies attached, so we can serve very low income families as well if those units, when those units turn over. And so the professional management company, what they do for us is they handle the income qualifying for all tenants who come through, and that's an annual process that has to be done that ensures that everybody is income qualified. They rent up the units, so they're screening tenants and they're advertising if our lists get lower. They handle the financial accounting, which then gets incorporated into our annual audit of Valley CDC. And they handle the maintenance and calls from tenants of, you know, if they're looking for a faucet or maintaining the buildings.
Joanne,
yes.
I did not realize this, but Valley CDC is a nonprofit corporation formed in 1988 by Kathy Latina.
Yep, it was an off. Yep, Kathy Latina folks at the time wanted to look at housing and the loss of all the jobs in the factories and stuff, and look at how to help low and moderate income folks.
That's another name. Mm-hmm. Wow, that's unbelievable. I want to thank you, Joanne,
you.
Donna,
me,
for coming and giving us the knowledge of what you're doing with the nonprofit corporation here. I think it's wonderful that we have people like you out in the community working with the city of Northampton. And I'm saying our city, because there's so many problems with housing, and there has been for a long period of time, and I'm still getting calls about more room, we need to keep people and get people out of the motels. That's a good deal.
Thank you very much.
Thank
you.
Appreciate
your time today. Your names.
I'm the big kahuna, apparently. No, my name is Rachel Kahuna-Dowell, and I'm the vice chair for the Northampton Housing Partnership. So the first goal in the housing plan was to create new housing ownership and rental opportunities and a variety of income levels. And over the last year, some of the activities that we undertook in order to achieve that goal was there were developer forums that we had. We worked with Wayne to put on a couple of these. One that Wayne had done was focused specifically on downtown. We then had last fall, about this time, we had another forum that we had downtown, and we talked about specific properties that were available within the town. We had some experts that had come in a few months earlier, and we walked downtown and we looked at some of these properties, what might be able to be developed there, what might be some thoughts that have happened in other towns. And we, like I said, looked specifically at some of those properties and tried to percolate some of these. As far as training opportunities, I believe I want to say, can you attend the Housing First training? So Housing First is a philosophy or a model of any homelessness where folks get put in housing first before you go through all of the, well, you got to do this first and then do this and then they give you housing. And there was a few training that was done at Hewitt Community College last week that brought in some best practices around the region. Thank you. So training ongoing in that. One of the things that is also one of the strategies identified within the housing plan is capitalizing the affordable housing trust fund. And there was revised ordinance that's going to the council about ways in which we could recapitalize that. CPC money is eligible to go into a housing trust fund if you have one available, so that would be one of the strategies that we can pursue with that. We're formalizing affordable housing review processes within the city as well, so CPC applications come before the housing partnership for review and sign off, and there's also a housing partnership rep that's on the section group. So we're seeing projects that will come in the early on process. And there's also a regional committee on affirmative and fair housing. We're continuing as the fair housing body in the charge of for the city. We're also keeping track on what's going on with fair housing and seeing on top of that. Other strategies under that first goal were regulatory. And one of them was adopting inclusion in Arizona, and we are forming a subcommittee for the housing partnership to look at inclusion in Arizona. And the new 7-unit plus proposal that's out has an option for inclusion in Arizona built into it. We are also happy to see that there are mixed use developments that you can now put first floor residential in the rear. Hope for Valley, CDC, and have to be able to put a few more units of housing in the first floor. As far as new housing production, which obviously is somewhat of a goal in the housing plan, there are 4 new projects that will be coming online. Soldier On has 44 units in the limited equity co-op, and 16 transitional units for women, veterans, and children. Christopher Heights project, 43 of the 83 units will be affordable at the hospital hill.
How many?
43.
And how many will be affordable out of that?
There's 83 units, 43 will be affordable. We've heard about Valley's new construction, which will be approximately 60 units. And then the former, or what is now the North Hampton Lodging, and from the North Pleasant Street, half housing is negotiating to purchase that property. Hold it as is an SRO, and manage it so the funding can be gathered, which will be many, many sources, and it will take a few years to do that. And it's still in the design process, but somewhere between 70 and 80 units of mixed income. One other thing around new housing production. Identified during the developer forum, the city-owned property. We are looking at the few options that we might have for city-owned property and how that might be able to be developed for affordable housing. Subsidy guarantee programs are also eligible under the CPC and the trust, so it's something that we're looking at as well. And CDBG supports down payment assistance, up to $3,000 down payment. The second goal, we may be reporting on, is preserving and sustaining existing affordable housing. And so, again, converting the 129 Pleasant Street, keeping it as SRO, and converting some of them to smaller studio units and SRO, the one way that we're preserving. And the existing affordable housing, there's some rehabilitation work down in the grocery unit. That property will always need some new work done on it, but we are continuing to keep that in our sights. And then our work to end homelessness, I'm going to turn over at this time to Rachel talk about the CPC funding that we got for that.
So the housing partnership has been able to, I guess, the proper word, $195,000 to go towards a 3-year contract to a human service agency to hire someone to work with folks in subsidized housing who may be at risk for addiction.
study done of 10 different units of subsidized housing, and it became obvious that in fact 97% of the people who are being evicted from subsidized housing are being evicted because of lack of ability to pay the rent. And we all know these are affordable homes, or this is affordable housing, and folks are only paying between 30-40% of their rent. So clearly there's some other issues here that might be getting in the way. And so the idea with hiring this perhaps counselor, I'm not sure if we actually have a title for this position yet, but is that there will be someone available to work with folks before they get, the courtroom. So we're in the process now, bless you, right on the RFR, and there are a couple agencies in the area that, in Northampton that we believe will certainly be interested. So that's pretty much where
we're at. Let me ask you to clarify something, maybe I missed it. You see, 97% of people who are evicted are able to pay the rent, and it's other reasons,
no,
or they're unable?
They're unable to pay the rent, so it's obviously not just a financial issue. There may be social services that need to be provided to someone, perhaps even, a financial guidance about, how to actually work with everything.
So unable to pay the rent because they don't have the money, or there are other issues? Mm-hmm. I'm not understanding.
Okay, so additional impediments are getting in the way of them being able to pay their rent. They have the income.
Okay,
they
so
wouldn't
that's
be able to move
confused,
in. Sorry.
You said unable to pay the rent, so
right.
I wasn't sure if you meant financially or
no,
because of those other impediments.
Right,
okay.
Right. There are other things that are getting in the way. Even something like, your car breaks down, you gotta get to work, which comes first, the car or the rent. So the idea is that we'll have someone there to kind of, to be there, to support, to put together different groups for people. If it's a group issue, provide people with knowledge about different social services that may be available to them. Because not everyone that moves into subsidized housing comes with support. Many of them do.
I'm glad that Councillor Klein had a question about that, because I was really confused a bit as far as that they're paying the rent,
sure,
but it wasn't a problem they're paying the
rent.
Right. And then you used an example as a car breaks down.
Mm-hmm.
I'm still having a problem with that. If a car breaks down,
mm-hmm.
you're saying that no matter what the cost is, that it could put them financially to make that payment for that rent for the month? And that's why somebody has to be called.
Yeah, if someone on a limited or a fixed income, it doesn't take much for an unexpected expense like that. Like, the engine goes, and I have to make a choice that week. Am I going to repair my car so that I can get to work and keep what little income I have coming in, or am I going to pay the rent? And sometimes people make choices to get their car repaired.
Okay. So what you do is that you get some form of an agency to come in, do counseling, to help them put money aside if possible, just in case there is an emergency or something.
So the idea is that we'll be sending out an RFR, and local agencies will respond. They will then, our hope is, hire an individual to meet with people who are in the situation and discuss the myriad issues. I mean, everyone, different people have different issues that come up that may prevent them from, or may they end up in a situation of eviction. And once you're evicted, trying to get into housing, any kind of housing, is just, we want to stop it before the process even starts.
As it's been explained to me, sometimes it's an organizational issue. They might just need help organizing how to get things done, or things that you may take for granted. They might need help figuring out negotiating the processes or setting up systems.
Sure. Not everybody comes with the same skill set, and so sometimes folks just need a little bit of guidance, and hopefully that's what the person will be doing.
But it certainly fills a service gap
It does.
And needs a real specific need for folks to preserve their tenancy. And that is one of the biggest things that you can do, is to keep people in their tenancy and keep them paying their rent on time. But once the process starts, you know, it's hard to get back on track. And even the stress, you know, of that happening to them sometimes causes it to spin more out of control. So so that's one of our homelessness prevention efforts. The city also continues to participate and offer some funding support to the Western Mass Network to End Homelessness, which is in the four counties of Western Mass. I'll be a co-chair of that, so I can report a little bit on that, the activities of the network presently. The network actually was able to garner an earmark in the budget that was just passed. And we are in the midst of having put out an RFR, RFP actually, for some services. And what we will be doing is aligning some of the strategic planning of the network and the work plan that we have put out with the federal plan to end homelessness that we can endure. And we see the network as an advocate around the public policy as it relates to homelessness, as well as educating the public, educating the consumers, educating the legislators. So there's two elements of the federal plan that deal with that, and we're going to be aligning our work plan for the next year with that. What's coming from this will really be an opportunity for us to look at the landscape in Western Mass. First of all, the network does not provide any direct services, but look at the landscape for homelessness services and do some analysis of what the data really is and how effective these what outcomes are being produced, so that we can say as a region of the things that we're doing moving the needle on homelessness. And so we've got some interesting reads on data collection and analysis, which is really the key piece that has been missing in all of the work that the network does, because there are disparate systems that everyone reports into around homelessness, and every program and funding source requires you to report differently and different things, and we're looking for a way to have one central repository that we can talk about what all this work is. Do you duplicate the people who are moving, you know, between counties, which gets confusing, and we're very excited to be working on that. It's also aligning it with the work of the PCSUs in the region. The other big thing that the network has done, Secure Jobs Initiative, was a program that was funded by the Fireman Foundation about a year and a half ago, which focused on homeless heads of households and placing them in job training and jobs. And the 18 months of that funding had them place over 100 heads of households into jobs, over an 80% retention rate, of course, 1 year later, who are still working. And since there are no new vouchers being produced by either the federal or a little bit on the state, but not enough to meet the need, Half Housing has 25,000 people on the waiting list for a Section 8 voucher. The last person taken off the waiting list was in 2003, so it's about a 10-year wait to get a voucher. The plan B is try to increase your income or get some income, because getting a voucher in order to subsidize your housing is not what's happening. Right?
25,000
people on the waiting list. The state recently unfroze 1,000 vouchers across the state for the state's voucher. Because there's a desperate need for housing across the state, so they
there's so many people
in motels. So they unfroze 1,000 of them. Half Housing got 58 vouchers. We have handed out 5,900 applications to go in the lobby for 58 vouchers. So the need for even shallow subsidy, any subsidy, you know, is there. There's clearly a capacity for affordable housing. It's missing. I think people are ending up in hotels and motels. But Secure Jobs looks at increasing income, getting people job training. So if you have some income coming in, we were able to support you. So we were able to get to
to leverage that funding from the Firelands Foundation because of how successful it was. And Secure Jobs actually got a line item in the state budget, funded initially by $500,000, to put it to work for doing the same thing, which is identifying a cohort of folks, and putting them through job training, matching, getting them ready, helping them interview, and you know, do whatever they need to do, and having flexible funds available with childcare and transportation and the flat tire on the car. What is the barrier that's, you know, keeping you from staying employed or getting employed and being able to put them in the home?
I have some serious problems about families with being in motels. Like, I gave an example of a family for a whole year now in Holyoke, in a motel, no kitchen facilities, a microwave oven, two small children, one goes to preschool, and so some of us constantly step in to help the parents out, and which is okay, because at first they got they were taken out of the motel, they don't know how to stay, and they were there for a whole year. He has no job, she has no job, but she has a college degree, very smart girl. It's the children. I can't understand how the state will allow small children to be in a motel, one room, no kitchen facilities. It's awful. So how come there is not a priority for a family with children first over somebody, maybe one person, a single person? I don't understand this, because even now, they're still back into the hotel. And I can't find them a place to live. Nowhere.
There's a capacity if you want to have them. The units that Northampton is being blessed to bring online, you know, 200 units of affordable housing in the upcoming year, is a blessing.
It is.
You know, being able to produce affordable housing and at rents that people truly can afford, and serving the folks who have very low income, is a difficult process. And so, you know, there's shelter capacity issues, and there's just affordable housing issues, and the state needs to, the state, but the state and federal government need to be able to provide, you know, what's missing. I think there's something to make this happen. And I was on the phone on the way up here, literally with people from DHCD, and no one thinks it's a great solution, but there are no shelter beds left. The shelter system is at capacity. So, car, under a bridge, or a motel room, and the default is become a motel room, but they are working vociferously to get as many units online as quickly as possible to get those.
So, Melissa, there is actually a priority for families over individuals. So, you're clear. There's a lot, there's a considerable amount more money that there is into housing families than there are individuals because of what we're talking about. Safety reasons, children living on the streets, is not acceptable. So, families are prioritized over individuals.
It's been over a year now. It's now the back
still
end of the end.
But it's the what we were talking about was just the precarious situations that people get about paying rent. It doesn't take much. There are many, many people that are, you know, just a, you know, a medical diagnosis or, you know, a car problem away from making their rent. And
this would be a loss of job.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Secure Jobs, you know, is certainly something that's happening in the region, that people on many levels are taking note of. I was just down in D.C. Last week. The Secure Jobs was invited with 11 other communities from across the country to go to a summit convened by the Department of Labor, and the HUD secretary was there to talk about how aligning workforce programs and the homelessness programs is a way to try to get out of this. And the federal government is taking note that jobs have something to do with it. But we're lucky here in Northampton that we have 200 units of affordable housing coming online, and some of it right in the urban core, which is not how
I think the city of Northampton is very fortunate to have the LACDC, have Housing Partnership be involved, working together with us as a city to try to help people not to become homeless.
Yep.
And it's been a big challenge, but we look at Grove Street and look what we've been doing with that. And it's volunteer work coming from residents, donating money to keep the upkeep on it. It's unbelievable.
Yeah, there's a lot of work to do.
I know.
Well, Michael, can you share some numbers about North Hampton specifically about homeless individuals, feeling that kind of thing? Is that easy to do off the top of your head? Or?
My job is actually the data coordinator for the Shelter and Housing Division of ServiceNet, so I do have some numbers available. what would you like to know? Because I've got a lot in there, and then some I don't have in there, so.
Well, currently, or, you know, recently, what the numbers were in terms of individuals, families, children, that kind of thing.
So families in Northampton is actually a non-issue. We don't house families in Northampton. There are shelters, the shelters that are in the area, or at least that serves now, that are the Greenfield family. And although we have just recently started working with the families in the motel, there are about 80 families in the motel in Greenfield that we're working with right now. The capacity of the Greenfield family is for 6 families at any given time. It's always full.
And that's regional, so they're coming from different parts of the...
All over the state. When an opening becomes available, you go where there's an opening. So people, the idea is that the system tries to keep people as local as possible, but you go wherever it is available. As far as individuals, I believe, there's the Grove Street Inn and then the Interfaith Winter Shelter. Of course, the Interfaith Winter Shelter is only open 6 months out of the year. I believe last year we served somewhere around 200 people within that 6 months. And the Grove Street Inn was probably about 145. The difference there, of course, is that at Grove Street you stay longer. But everyone is working as a case manager. You can't stay in the shelter unless you're working as a case worker. I say you can't stay, you get a set period of time that you stay at the shelter, and if within that time if you are not working as a case manager, you have time to move on.
Do you deal with community action also?
Yes. Me or ServiceNet?
I'm talking about Housing Partnership. Do you deal with community action also? Because they sometimes need to have help finding apartments and so forth.
That's not really our purview so much. No,
we're aware of what the direct service providers are doing, within the region, but we're not with the partnership that's involved in doing that.
Still doing a great job.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
I could provide you with some specific numbers. Those are really off the top of my head, but if you'd like, I can.
If you have them easily, if you're already creating other things, I would love to see that.
We could. Thank you.
And have nice holidays.
Thank you.
They're coming around the corner. Okay. Take that order at 4:55 p.m. I wanted to talk about our November schedule, the resolution on vibrant sidewalks, and how the committee wants to handle this. I know that Bill Newman had given some really good suggestions, so maybe we can talk about that too.
Yeah,
for example.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm getting snuffed up again. ServiceNet coming in. I have Jay coming in, and there is a new employee now at the shelter. Danielle, who you met, has left. She has a new job. And we have Katie, who's the new director at the Grove Street. and I heard she's fantastic, so they're going to be coming in to talk with us, and that is going to happen on the times from 4 or 5 p.m. until about 4 to 5 o'clock, because I know they're going to have a lot to talk about the shelters now. I mean, there's a lot of concerns about people now starting to sleep on the streets, finding warmth and so forth like that. Then we have Pennybrook coming in at 5 o'clock, right? And do you know what her agenda is going to be?
Do you know their answer?
It's the same thing. I
handed it over to you when you sent that email.
Yeah, well, she's my neighbor. So.
Right. So I.
So it must be the same what you had talked about, of trying to see how we can go ahead and work with
her. I think that's the email that she sent back.
Yeah. Right. Okay. Thank you, Lisa. And then the vibrant sidewalks at 5:30. I have an hour.
I'm just wondering, because if we're actually planning on making recommendations about change language or things to include, then half an hour actually isn't enough. I mean, I think that it would be really useful for us to hash out some language together, and that could take a while.
I also know that Adam is working on the Bible
school. Is he?
Yeah, right now. So.
Oh, okay. Well, I'll talk with him. And there's a possibility maybe we'll have some of that language, and then we can bring it up again for December. What's that sound?
If you've already invited people, we don't have
a
chance to stretch.
I do have some people coming in, which you know, I already told you that. And there's a possibility Castle Latino will be coming in for about 20 minutes.
Well, the more time we can have for that,
yeah,
the better. So yeah, if there's somebody that, you know, can't come, or I think I personally think that would be a good use of our time.
Right. Well, we're going to have some half an hour for November, and then December again. We should be pretty well in the way. So we figure.
I'm wondering if Councilor Sharon knows when everyone should get this revised and out the door.
It's not going back to Ebo.
It's not going back to Ebo?
No. It doesn't go back to Ebo. It goes to, because this is a second reading, once we do amendments on it, because these are amendments closing out, then it goes, but doesn't it go back to ordinance, or does it go right to City Council? Ordinance, right?
I don't know that it wouldn't
take
up the resolution.
I know it doesn't go back to economic development housing, because we already did a first reading.
Whatever the case may be, because we're actually talking about creating amendments and new language and different language,
yes,
that's, you need to perfect it. And this is
definitely
the place that we do that. Does that sound off base to either of you?
Mm-hmm.
That we would just need a good chunk of time to,
sure,
you come up with language that we all agree on.
We can do that.
And
like an hour. Does that sound okay?
We don't have any kind of deadline by which we're supposed to get this in.
No.
Putting
not
it off to December means essentially.
Yeah.
We're not,
because I can ask Brian Foote.
Ideas.
I thought it was a good idea for you to have him come to City Council, Brian Foote. Mm-hmm. So what we can do is we could keep this meeting for December strictly on vibrant sidewalks.
I think that's good.
How's that?
That's good. I mean, I can also ask him for Adam.
Yeah.
And it would have to be here if this is the last.
Exactly.
It's going to happen, no?
Yeah.
Unless you just bring it straight to the
council. Right,
unless you hold
it.
Right. I'm not sure what the council is. So you can bring on her and mention he can bring his, or
yes,
you can share them with us first, and we can
work
on them
together. And I might like to do that. It's all based on that last hearing we had and what had come up.
I mean, I think I have really extensive notes from both hearings, and I think it would be really useful for each of us to share the things that we think are most salient and the kinds of pieces we want to see actually added or amended.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And I just think that listening to each other's main points and then crafting them and deciding whether or not we want to craft them into language and then crafting them into language could be a lengthy process.
Right. because I really liked what Bill Newman talked about. Okay.
I think there were a lot of good conversations.
Yeah, there was, definitely. Really, so let's plan on a half an hour for November, and then we got 2 hours for December. Does that sound okay?
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you. I just wanted to let you counselors know that I received an email from Steve Connors this afternoon, it was probably about 1:45, that he apologizes, not realizing he looked at his calendar. And he goes, he made a mistake. He apologizes. He apparently had the opportunity to go to a conference with his partner, and what we have done is, and he's worked on it, he has Dom Jira, would you can come up to the front, please? That's Steve's assistant to the Veterans Office. So he's going to talk about the budget and the caseloads. Thank you, Tom, for coming in.
No problem.
My pleasure. Yeah, this is Counselor from Ward 4, Gina Louise Sierra. And to the left is Alyssa Klein, Counselor from Ward 7, and I'm City Councilor Marianne LaBarge from Ward 6.
Nice to meet you.
Could I have one more?
Sure.
Thank you. You can have a seat right there.
I just want to let you know that it's this committee that borrowed your overhead.
Oh, okay. Which I still have, by the way. Oh, great.
Locked up in the vault. Thank you.
All
right.
Thank you. She's right.
Trying
to tell you that we're going to be.
Yeah. Oh, thank you.
All right.
Okay.
So basically, our budget for this year was $679,500. Right now, the only 2 months that we have closed out are July and August. So we're still working on September, and October will be coming after that. So after we closed out August, our current balance is $479,667.38. For the month of July, our veterans benefits, we spent $70,217, and we're going to be reimbursed $55,660. For August, we spent $49,595, and we will be reimbursed $39,467. Now, there's certain expenses that are generally the veterans benefits are around 75%. There are some 100% reimbursable expenses, and I know Steve probably covered this in the past. Basically, there's with a lot of our cases, we can't really predict how much we're going to spend one way or another, just because there's for medical payments or medical reimbursable expenses, we just can't predict what that would be. But it looks like, according to the numbers here, we budgeted pretty accurately for the year. So up to this point, only having considering 2 months, but it's looking pretty good so far. And I know that we don't have any unauthorized expenses that aren't reimbursable to this point.
Now, you have the same sheet that,
yes,
that you're reading off on that?
Yes, I have. I have the same packet that I just handed out. Do I have any questions? Yes.
I guess the overarching question I have is just this covers all the towns that the veterans agents serve, right?
No, this is
this
for
is just
North Hampton.
Hampton. It's yeah. Just North Hampton.
Can you explain the 900 for food?
Definitely get back to you on that. I don't know what the itemized expenses are, but I'll definitely address that.
That, it seems like in the past you just said that that's emergency food assistance.
Maybe it is.
Yeah. That's what he said last time he was here.
I know we do get. As far as that's concerned, the one thing I do know about that is we do get food vouchers from various places to hand out in emergency situations.
That could be it, yeah. Okay.
And how many people are you serving these days in Northampton? Do you know kind of off the top of your head?
It's right around the 200 mark. Somewhere around there, give or take.
Now, we're spread out though. Because we are also working in other areas, correct?
Right, yes.
So, like, you're in now working with Steve,
yes.
And what areas are you covering from?
I predominantly cover the hill towns, Goshen, Huntington,
yeah.
Williamsburg, Chesterfield, Worthington, and Middlefield. I also cover we all kind of work together, but I'm the one to go on site for the hill towns and actually be present there for our veteran service hours.
Because I know Steve was really looking at that a couple of years ago. He had great concerns of getting the outer areas of the towns being covered because there was problems there. So everything is going much
better
now?
Yeah, it seems to be going very smooth. I have a... great feedback from all the hill towns.
That's great.
Yeah, and it seems to be doing very well. I'm trying to get people involved more in the hill towns as far as participation for preparing for the Veterans Day events and Memorial Day.
Mm-hmm.
We have Joe Russo, my predecessor.
Yeah.
He started a Hilltown Veterans Council, and that's kind of, it's still in the beginning stages, really, and it was left at that, but it's really coming along, and I see some interest to have more people come on and be more active in those areas as well.
Thank you, Ken, very, very much for being here, and have good holidays.
Great.
We'll see you again till next year, probably.
All right, thank you very much.
Thank
Appreciate
you. Brad LeVay.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Hello, folks.
Hello.
Should I say shalom?
Thank you, Norbert, again for being here and Veterans Council.
I think I want to get a little
okay. And Norbert, thank you again. Thank you.
You're welcome, Mary.
And Brad, are you going to talk first? Because I don't want two people talking.
I just want to say good evening to you all.
Good evening.
My name's Brad LeVay. I'm the president of the Veterans Council in Northampton. We're here tonight to discuss what we have left of this year for our activities. And I brought along with me my vice president, Tim Daly. He is also the chairman of our activities committee, so he'll make the report. And I have Norbert with us, our secretary. Feel free to ask anything you want to ask.
Well, we're going to go ahead and let Tim Daly go ahead and speak now, because I think he has some things to be talking about.
I got that.
Thank you.
Okay. We participated for the third year in the St. Patrick's Day Parade. I'm just giving you a run-up to where we are right now.
Yeah.
Flag Day retirement, World War II took care of that this year. And that's a private ceremony. It's a formal ceremony. And we had a scout from Troop 103 who used that flag retirement as part of his Eagle project. And that was sponsored by World War II this past year. In the past, it's been the Legion. And they burned approximately 2,000 flags that were turned in at Big Y, at the Elks, at the Legion, at the VFW. And we decided that that's got to be an annual requirement because 3 years ago when we started this, we had 9 pickup truck loads of flags that we had to burn in one day. And by doing it every year, it's a lot more reasonable. The Leeds Memorial went well. Memorial Day Parade went well. Probably the Memorial Day Parade in Florence, we probably had the greatest participation we've had in the last 10 years. It was tremendous. And the VFW put on the coalition for all participants after the parade, and that was a success. Flag Day at the Elks in June. We probably had a better turnout this year than we had the last 2 years that we've incorporated with the Elks to do a Flag Day ceremony. Pulaski Day, we participated with a vehicle, and we've done that for the last 3 years, so that was good. The annuals, now I'll start with what we have ahead of us.
Yes.
Veterans Day Salute Breakfast will be November 8th at the Elks. Tickets are available. I hope we have some participation. I talked with Dave
Markowitz.
No, Dave Markowitz last week, and he plans on attending. So if anybody wants tickets, they're available either at the Veterans Office. I have tickets.
I got my
Norbert has tickets. Okay. We have this year, the speaker is going to be the new director of the VA, which I think is appropriate. He wanted to introduce himself to the community, and I think this is a good opportunity for him to see the veterans and see what the veterans in our area are doing. So that's our speaker for Veterans Day Breakfast. Veterans Day Parade, we have another Northamptonite. Pete Parody, who is now the assistant director of Holyoke Soldiers Home, will be our speaker in November. And the coalition after that will be at the World War II Club this year.
What day is the parade?
November 11th.
November 11th. And isn't there also something going on the 10th at the Senior Center for the Veterans?
I have no idea. It's nothing that we have any part of.
Wow.
This will be this year will be 11-11.
Yeah, you're right.
11-11-11, yeah.
Huh. So,
yeah. It goes back to Armistice Day.
No.
Oh,
11th month, 11th hour.
11th yep. day.
11th day.
Right.
So that's going to be at the Bridge Street School. That's what we're going to
do. That's where the parade starts.
We start at the cemetery.
Yeah, at the Lampert Park.
Yep. What time does it start?
The parade kicks off at 11 o'clock. It's usually, it gets to Pulaski Park probably 11:30 by the time you get the last contention card.
And then what's after that, after the parade is where?
the coalition is out there in World War II vet.
That's what they're having?
Yeah. It rotates. If you can follow my reasoning. VFW, World War II. Elks Memorial Day, Legion Memorial Day. So it's every 2 years. Well, there's four organizations that put on the coalition, so it swaps out. So that's how it works.
Are you going to go ahead and put some article in the Gazette to let people know about the breakfast on November 8th?
Well, we have found that the Gazette, even last year, I think we spent almost $400.
And we don't get any breaks.
And so we're going to do one. We're only going to do one advertisement in the paper. There's posters.
And
all
the
veterans organizations
are stuck in not doing a letter to the editor and something else that you don't have to pay for in the Gazette.
Yeah.
Right. And how about doing it on the radio?
I spoke to Tom Pease. He's going to have an ad put in under
the Veterans Voice.
Why don't you go on the radio?
And that's free.
That's free. The radio's free.
Yeah, the radio's free.
But, you know, our
budget. Put the poster on NCTV also. That's free.
Our budget is. You know what our budget is. It's not great.
No. No, but it is free. You take your poster and bring it up to NCTV. They'll shrink it down and they'll have it going.
Well, we can do that.
That saves you money.
Yep.
We did sell out last
year. I'll talk with Tom and talk with him because I really need to do that.
Veterans Day, I'm glad to see they haven't started construction in Pulaski Park because I think that was one of the best moves we made in the last few years, and I kind of instituted it, but it saved a whole lot of people standing on Main Street.
You're speaking about the move from the front of the building, we go around to the side.
Right.
And,
yeah.
I didn't know if you were.
And it's a little warmer.
It sure is. I agree with you. I think once they revitalize that park, we're all going to be happy with it because it's in dire need.
Well, I would like to see some additional flagpoles in that so that on Veterans Day we could put up all the service flags.
How much the fiesta?
Like they do at the World War II, you see the flagpoles for all the services.
I'd like
to
see that in here.
That's probably something for you to talk about with Tommy Pease and do a fundraiser.
Mm-hmm. Well, we got to see the plans first, see what they're going to do.
Exactly.
But,
you know,
this year, everybody knows the cost of food has gone up. And we voted as a committee to keep our price at $12. So
for the breakfast.
We there's a lot of elderly veterans that come, and hey, they're all on short money, especially with the economy. And we decided that we would keep our tickets at $12. We're probably going to have to dip into we're going to have to dip into our treasury to cover.
The problem is that there's one reason on the advertising, but we also have expanded the program to include the youth chorus from GFA, the GFT.
Yeah.
Well, it's 8 or 10 more meals, and they do not pay. No speaker pay.
Can you give them child size meals?
It gets charged by the head. And you ever try to feed a child a child size meal?
Yeah, especially
at a normal size meal.
But what about like with the Elks? Because they let you have it there.
They're coming to be the bargain in town.
They're doing more than the city did for us at the senior center and Smith School.
No charge for janitors.
But it should be. That's our club.
No charge.
No charge.
No charge for the hall. The only thing the caterer, the only thing, even the caterer doesn't have to pay the commission on the meals, and that's why he gives us what he gives us. But I talked with Seth about it, and Seth says, "Tim, I can't do it for what I've been doing it." He says, "Look, it. This is what I was buying bacon for a year ago. This is what I'm buying today."
He's going to survive.
I mean, he's and he's been more than fair. More than fair.
It's the best place we've been to.
Last year we had.
I agree.
Yeah. Last year we had 140 something people left. He charged us only for 130 people. So, I mean, he's been.
He goes out of his way.
More than fair. And he says that's his contribution.
Is it mostly vets and their families, or is it other
people? No, no, anybody can go.
Anybody can come.
Yeah.
But it's a lot of family people.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
No,
well, you saw it last year. I mean,
I go every year.
The hall was packed. I mean, you know,
I thought we were going to have to give up our seats.
Yep.
I really did. We had people eating up in the corridor.
Yes, that's true.
You know, so
they're wonderful.
We were really satisfied with the people showing up.
It's since our first one at the senior center, I think. It's elevated, it's gotten participation, and
the one at Smith
so many of the people come.
Smith Location, oh, that was a good one.
Yeah, but why did we have to pay $320? We had to pay for a custodian the night before so we could set up.
So why did
we had to pay for a custodian.
And we did most of the work.
And we did all the work. He
we'd
just
go
stood there
and a custodian would open the door and we'd have to bring the chair, bring the table, and pay them.
And then we had to pay for a supervisor in the kitchen because we had an outside caterer.
So my question is, you went there, you got the price, so why did you take it? Did you go somewhere else?
This is when we started.
This is when we first started.
When we first started, we didn't know any better. We smartened up real quick.
We didn't have the capacity at the senior center after.
We had no other choice.
After the Purple Heart breakfast that we did, we just couldn't get any more people in there. The following year, we did the Vietnam veterans. And we had 160 something people. We had to have it at a bigger hall. So we figured that the city would give us a break, but we didn't get any break. So after that, I decided.
Tim, excuse me, you have gotten a break from the city. We got you a little budget there.
Well, we didn't have
that's
it.
Important.
We didn't have that.
No, but we didn't have that.
We didn't have that back then.
That's
back
a
then
shame,
we didn't have
should've.
That.
Yeah. Well, and it made like
right.
We probably got the most active Veterans Council in the state.
Yeah. That's good though.
I mean, we.
Well, look at you. You never stop.
No. I can't. Pearl Harbor Day, which was a. Started by East Hampton is our last event of the year. That's December 7th. It's a Sunday. The ceremony starts at 12:30 on the bridge, on Route 5, Pearl Harbor Day Bridge. And East Hampton has kind of backed off because they don't have the organization we have. And I guess we kind of got that dumped in the last.
And this year, on December 7th, corresponds to December 7th of 1941.
Right.
So it's the Sunday. Exact day.
Yeah.
Yep.
So,
it's a...
Bring your overcoats.
It's cool.
It's cold.
But the...
Your leg warmers.
World War II will have a beef stew and... For us afterwards, so. You get warm and have a libation, and that basically winds out our year.
And we'll have you come back then next year before we start up with the parades again and other functions.
Well, I think probably April or first part of May is a good time. By then we'll have a calendar together. And
yeah, we'll know what we're doing.
We'll know what we're doing.
Thank you for all your hard work.
I appreciate it.
Anybody else? Any questions?
No, we're going to be the best.
We'll see you.
Oh, we have to go to another meeting.
We have our activities meeting.
Everybody was said hello.
We postponed it till 7:00.
If you need us, just call.
Thank you.
Yep.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you for having us. No, it feels good that we can do something good for the community, you know.
Is everybody still on the committee, or have you lost any of them on your committee on the back?
Actually, we've gained.
Have you?
The 49ers have given us two participants on the activities committee.
Nick Grimaldi
and Carl Grahowski. And yeah. The one you beat in the election.
Gene
has become active on the activities committee.
But that's very good.
So it's worked out well. We've lost a few.
I'm glad I can free him up for the activity, for other activities.
Excuse me. He's been on it. He's helped us with the setup at the cemetery and at the where we set up the platforms and everything. So, it's good. And basically, my committee runs about 8 people.
That's good.
But I mean, it's 8 people that are committed. And
do we have any female vets in Northampton that participate?
They're on the Veterans Council. There's the speaker that did Memorial Day. I can't think of her name. Retired colonel. You know who I mean?
Yeah.
She's on the Veterans Council from the VFW.
Kathy Silva?
Yeah.
Kathy's on it.
She's been on it for quite a while.
Yeah.
Also,
I mean, if anybody wants to come, we don't have any.
We got work for everybody.
We can find something for you to do, that's for sure.
The memorial at St. Mary's Cemetery.
Mm-hmm.
With the papers over there.
Mm-hmm.
Boy, that's really expanding, because they're putting in 3 of them for my family, for my husband and his 2 brothers. That's
Brad
beautiful there.
I know Brad bought a bunch.
Well, I've got 2 uncles buried there in World War II. Veterans Day is very sentimental for me, because my uncle was killed in 1944 on November 11th. 2 days after he was awarded a Silver Star.
Wow.
Yeah, where was he?
France, Ardent. His name's on the stone out there.
I feel like you're
going to
go solve some crime and you look like Sherlock Holmes.
I know, my
doesn't. This is Meow Father's Irish Walker hat. He passed away, he left it to me.
I love that hat.
You can tell it's Father's because he always wore the dolphin.
When you wear it, you have to speak with an Irish accent, right?
No, I just get a hoot out of doing it.
Thank you very much.
I have an Irish Walker that fits better.
Someday I'd love to sit and talk with you about the IDF.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's do it.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. Yeah. I was there in 97 to 2000.
I know, you told me.
Yeah.
I served from 78 to 1980, so quite a while. Already.
Yeah. Yeah.
Where was this, Lisa?
I was in New Jersey only for 2 years.
I spent part of my last few years in the military. I spent 4 years in Israel. Yeah. Sometime we got to do that.
Okay. Sounds good.
Take care.
Bye. Bye. Thank you.
Thanks for coming.
Thank you very much.
You're more than welcome.
Second. All in favor?